Ladies and gentlemen, in the year 1588, when the old minaret of the former great mosque of Granada was about to be taken down, workers discovered a box with some saintly relics and a large sheet of parchment covered with texts in Arabic, Spanish, and Latin. Then, from the year 1595 and onwards, a total of 22 lead booklets were discovered in the caves of Valparaiso Hill, outside Granada, together with some mortal remains attributed to the earliest apostles of Christianity to Spain, especially Granada, in the first Christian century. After the speedy authentication of the relics, not of the books, the hillock of Valparaiso was renamed Sacro Monte, Holy Mountain, and it became a center for pilgrimage and religious life. Under the personal supervision of the Archbishop of Granada, Don Pedro de Castro, detailed notes were made about the dates and circumstances of the discoveries. After his death, Estepa continued this work, and his Christianizing translation became the standard reference for the study of the lead books. In our work, we were able to critically study the impressive, though not always impartial, work of the translators and other scholars working for de Castro and afterwards. And likewise, we were able to make use of the voluminous archive of the Vatican Commission of scholars who deciphered, translated, and evaluated the documents after their transfer to Rome, and who concluded that the parchment, as well as the lead books, were heretical and to be prohibited. This judgment was confirmed by the Pope in a special bull of 1682. From that year onwards, the materials remained inaccessibly preserved within the secret archives of the Vatican. At the recommendation of Cardinal Ratzinger, eo tempore, head of the Congregation of the Doctrine of the Faith, and hoc tempore, Papa Emeritus, Pope John Paul II decided to return the materials to Granada, where the Archbishop finally granted us permission to prepare a critical edition and translation, a project which now approaches its completion. We should like, once again, to express our deepest gratitude to His Eminence, the Archbishop of Granada, and to all the staff of the Sacro Monte Archives for having facilitated our work. When it was found in a box of lead, the parchment was folded. Its wild and cursive Arabic script with Maghribi features combines elements of fantasy and of a hybrid nature, where individual letters are often completely obscured and diacritical signs are usually omitted, with the result of a largely undecipherable text. Illustration number one, illustration numero uno, gives some fragments of the parchment. And those who are specialists in Arabic will immediately see the degree of difficulty of reading this text. Though the condition of the ink has deteriorated through the ages, we believe that the opaqueness of the Arabic text was made willfully by the writers of the text on the parchment in order to add to its enigmatic character. In his time, the famous Arias Montano not only rejected it as a falsification, but also concluded to its illegibility. Our conclusion doesn't differ essentially from his. The fact that Miguel de Luna and Alonso del Castillo were able to produce transcripts implies, in our view, that at least one of them, probably Luna, had access to another copy of the same text in a legible form. The Latin script used in the Spanish prophecy is interspersed with various kinds of fantasy forms as well, including Greek letters, mainly capitals. The composer of the parchment calls himself in an Arabic signature Cecilio, Bishop of Granada. Returning from a pilgrimage to Jerusalem, where he had visited, among others, the grave of Jesus, in whom he believes as the second person in the Trinity, he brought back with him a prophecy about the destruction of the world, ascribed to San Juan the Evangelist and Apostle. He, Cecilio, had translated this originally Hebrew prophecy from Greek into Spanish. Its commentary he translated from Greek into Arabic. On behalf of the Moth Arabs, Arabophone Christians living in Spain. The precise meaning of both the Spanish prophecy and its poetical commentary in Arabic are opaque and obscure, and as can be expected of oracles and prophecies in general, they can be interpreted in many different ways, especially because the poems of which the commentary consists can, according to contemporary Morisco authors, be constructed in different manners. In a final note on the parchment, this time in Latin, a servant of Cecilio by the name of Patricius informs us that his master Cecilio, when he saw the end of his life and his martyrdom drawing near, had asked him to hide the treasure of the prophecy and relics in a safe place, lest they would get lost or ever come into the power of the Moors, the Muslims. One thing that seems to be evident from all this is that the author postulates that Cecilio was living in a time prior to the arrival of Arabs and Islam in Spain. This corresponds with the belief that the former minaret of the Great Mosque of Granada, where the box with the parchment was discovered, was also dated back to ancient pre-Islamic, namely Roman times. The lead book will provide us with many more details about Cecilio's background, activities and companions. It has become nowadays customary to speak of the lead books, the Libros Plumbeos. But the materials concerned, in fact, consist of very small round pieces of lead with a small hole in each of them to allow a cord of lead to pass and keep the various leaves of one booklet together. If you look at illustration number two, illustración número dos, you can see such a plomo with its hole where the cord would have to be passing through. Its real size is just only 4 centimeters. It has been enlarged here to allow to become more visible and more easily to be read and seen. Some booklets have only a few of these leaves or tablets. Others may have more than 20. So we have 22 of these booklets, and they are varying in length. Both by their material aspects and their added characteristics, they present themselves as Islamic amulets. Islamic lead seals are usually very old, from the 8th till the 10th centuries we have them, which may have been the main reason why the authors chose this material, namely to give them an ancient look and to lend credence to the claim that they had been made in times immemorial, namely in the first century of Christianity. The main protagonists in the lead books are, first of all, Jesus, Sayyiduna Yasuo ibn Maryam. This is his name in Arabic. It is the Islamic form which is used here. We shall come back to that. Our Lord Jesus, the son of Mary, Sayyiduna Yasuo ibn Maryam, and Mary, As-Saliha Maryam al-Adhra, the Holy Virgin Mary. Then there are the Apostle James, Ya'qub al-Hawari, and his disciple, Cecilio, Sa'is al-Aya, in Arabic, Sa'is al-Aya. So the author suggests that Cecilio is originally an Arabic name. It is derived from Arabic, Sa'is al-Aya, Cecilio, whom we have already met in the parchment in his capacity of the Bishop of Granada. He is said to be of Arab origin and usually functions as the secretary writing down the Arabic texts of the lead books conveyed to him by the Apostle James, who often had received them from the Virgin Mary. Let's have a look at the Arabic script. This is an archaic kind of script, and it is characterized by the fact that many parts of the script are, which would go beyond the line, they are sublimated into the lines. Here you can see, you have an example, you see everywhere lines. The letters are written on the lines, but parts of the letters disappear into the lines. If you write, for instance, an N, a noon in Arabic, you write like this. You only see now this on the line. The rest disappears into the lines. That is the main characteristic of this script and its archaic appearance. It's not an innovation of the lead books, but can be traced also in the text of amulets and seals in magical writings that circulated among the Muslims of Spain. For instance, in a 15th century manuscript, which was found in Ocaña, in the province of Toledo. You can have a look here. Illustration number 3. You have here a seal, an amulet, with exactly the same script on lines. So it is not an innovation, and it is not only from known from Spain, but it is also known from Near Eastern countries. Magical bowls, magical texts, they have similar samples of seals. I have here for you illustration number 4. You can see it in your booklet, illustration numero 4. A magical bowl from Cairo from the beginning of the 14th century, the Mamluk period. Exactly the same phenomenon. So here we are in the world of Islamic magic. Magic in the Islamic world. The name of the script, does it have a name? According to a Latin inscription on one of the first lead books, its name would be the script of Solomon. Liber Fundamenti Ecclesiae Salomonis Caracteribus Escriptus, the book of the fundament of the church written in the characters of Solomon. It is possible that the name Characters of Solomon, or Solomonic script, or in Arabic Al-Qalam al-Sulaimani, would have been the name of the script used among the Moriscos. But we have not been able to trace this name in Arabic or other Islamic sources which are independent from the lead books. It only appears in this Latin text in the lead books. In an article of 1921, French Orientalist Casanova was discussing some amulets from the Near East and also some magical manuscripts, where this script was called Al-Qalam al-Nabati, the Nabatean script. He himself coined the script as Kufic Linear. He also said that the lines into which the script disappears partly is the main characteristic and its forms, its archaic forms. So he called it Kufic Linear. Anyhow, this is the script of the lead books. And although many of these texts, like the one in the Miscellaneo de Solomon from Ocaña, it has no meaning. It has no meaning at all. It is just pseudo-cryptography. But in the lead books, the texts are do have a meaning, do have a sense. The script is used to express Arabic texts, not only mysterious, undecipherable texts, but really Arabic texts. Except for three lead books. They contain a cryptic script which has defied all scholars who have worked with this material since the end of the 16th century. Also the Vatican Commission, which consisted of really great scholars, was unable to decipher this script. In some cases, it's only a few words, but in one lead book, number 17, entitled Haqiqat al-Injil, The Essence of the Gospel, and Gerard, he will come to speak more extensively about this booklet, has been written completely in this mysterious script. You can have a look at illustration number 5 to have a first page of the Haqiqat al-Injil. And there you see a specimen of this script. Illustration numero 5. You have this script. Those who know Arabic, they will immediately see that this is something completely different. This is not Arabic at all. This is, well, so it is a cryptographic text. And it is possible in the study of Islamic civilization to distinguish between two separate cryptographic traditions. The first of these figures in magical text and consists of a variety of alternative alphabets, different from the usual Arabic alphabet. And we have a number of Arabic authors who have produced books where they discuss these magical alphabets, like Ibn Rushdie and Al-Jildaki, but there are others. In these books, the numbers of the non-Arabic signs are more or less identical to the number of the letters of the Arabic alphabet. The idea is here that certain Arabic names and words which the author of a text wanted to keep secret or of limited access were presented by him in one of these mysterious alphabets. So it was only accessible to insiders who knew these alphabets. The second tradition is a cryptographic tradition in the real sense of the word, in that this tradition bears various examples of forms of cryptography used for official purposes, for instance in letters and documents containing state secrets. This tradition is characterized by the substitution of Arabic letters by other Arabic ciphers and letters or by symbols of different origin in accordance with certain secret formulas. The famous 9th century scholar Al-Kindi wrote a study analyzing the different types of encipherment. In the case of our lead books, would be dealing with the first tradition, the magical tradition. But the truth of the matter is that our mysterious script, contains many more different signs than the letters of the Arabic alphabet. And we are thus inclined to conclude that we are dealing here with a case of pseudo-cryptography, not uncommon in magical texts. I could show you amulets, Islamic amulets with pseudo-Hebrew script or pseudo-Syriac script, suggesting a very mysterious text, but which in fact are illegible and have no meaning. So we are dealing, it is our conclusion, that we are dealing here with a text of which the script does not reflect a meaning. It has a meaning, the text, and Gerard will explain this to you, hopefully. It has a meaning, but not through its script. Now, the images of the Seal of Solomon in the lead books. Drawings of the already mentioned Seal of Solomon figure at the beginning and end of most of the lead books. Apart from their decorative role, in the beginning of the mysterious book number 17, which is the most important book of the whole collection, you have a poetical text, a prophetical poetical text, which you can see in illustration number 8, illustration numero 8. You see here the star of Solomon, the Seal of Solomon, and on every side there is an Arabic text. We have reproduced here the Arabic text and we have given its translation. I will not take much time to read it for you. You can read it at your ease. And connected to the other parts of our lecture. In one of the smaller lead books, an explanation is given of the origin and power of the Seal of Solomon. See plate 9, illustration numero 9, here. This is from a small booklet, it is called Kitab Tawrikh, not Tarikh, but Tawrikh, Ghatam Sulaiman, the book of the history of the Seal of Solomon. It's just a very short text which explains the origin of this seal. It describes how Solomon received this sign from God on his ring. Ghatam also means ring, not only seal, but also ring. Empowering him to rule over demons and spirits. Seduced by the devil in the form of a woman of outstanding beauty, I'm sorry, it's like that in the text, a woman of outstanding beauty, he lost the ring, but in the end was able to retrieve it and restore order in his realm. The shield of David, Magen David, or the seal of Solomon, as it is exclusively called in Arabic, Magen David, that is the Hebrew name, the Star of David, has its origin in pre-Islamic Jewish magic. Originally, Solomon's ring was not covered by the magical emblem of a 6 or 5-pointed star, but by the holy, unpronounceable name of God, the Tetragrammaton. Important elements of the story, as recounted in this small text, are of Jewish origin as well. But with important Islamic elements added, just as is the case with so many other so-called Islamic prophetic tales, Qisas al-Anbiya. This has its place in the context of the tales of the Prophet. And in these tales, which were also very popular among the Muslims in Spain and the Moriscos, there many Jewish elements had been introduced, like also in this text. The lead books present different styles in relation to a variety of subject matters. First of all, there are discursive treatises of religious doctrines and rules. Among them, we find texts on the fundamental articles of faith, on the divine essence, the ritual of the Mass, a catechism in 2 copies, a text about paradise and hell, one on the nature of the angels, and a list of religious rules and wisdoms. The dialogue in the form of questions and answers is a second characteristic literary style to be observed in some lead books. Sometimes the questions are posed by Peter, the vicar, al-Khalifa, the vicar, the pope. He wants to say the pope, al-Khalifa. And the answers given to him by the Holy Virgin Mary, as in the history of the essence of the gospel, Kitab Tawrikh Hakikat al-Injil, the history of the essence of the gospel. In the Ascension of Mary, another booklet, it is Mary herself who asks the questions, while Gabriel and others give the answers. We find the same form and style in the Virtues of the Essence of the Gospel. Stylistically speaking, these texts are strongly reminiscent of the Islamic literature of the so-called Munajat, the intimate conversations, for instance, between Moses and God. Then, the third category, there are narrative texts, as in the life of Jesus and the life of James, dealt with in 2 parts, in 2 separate lead booklets. A fourth group has theological texts in a solemn and elevated language, in rhymed prose, strongly reminiscent of the Quran. a Muslim who would hear these texts and who read these texts immediately associates and recognizes the language of the Quran. This was, of course, in the translations of the late 16th and the early 17th century, this was no longer, this had disappeared completely, this Islamic element of the language of all the Latin books. This same style is occasionally also applied in a historical text, as in the booklet I already mentioned in the history of the Seal of Solomon. I want to say something about the language, the grammar, and the vocabulary. We have compared the language with the grammatical sketch of the Spanish-Arabic dialect by Federico Corriente. This is the criterion we have used to judge the language of our text. And we have concluded, and we give here many examples, I don't need to bother you with all these small linguistic details, we have concluded that the language is the dialect as it was current in the second half of the 16th century in Granada, which is quite obvious, of course, which is quite logical, because that is the place and that is the time where these texts came into being. Those who are interested can check this. The vocabulary. The Islamic background of the author or authors transpires on every page of the Latin books by their use of expressions, even the shortest ones, derived from the two fundamental normative sources of Islam, namely the Quran and the tradition literature, the Hadith, which consists of reports about sayings and deeds of Muhammad or one of his companions. Here we are witnessing the creation of an Islamic atmosphere, an Islamic language creating an Islamic atmosphere, where an audience with a Muslim background would easily feel at home. At the same time, there is a complete avoidance of the exposition of any specific Islamic doctrine or any explicit reference to Islam, the name of Muhammad, for instance, not being mentioned a single time in any of the 22 Lead books. The Islamic expressions as well as major Islamic images are applied here to Christian figures. The ascension, the Mi'raj, of the Holy Virgin Mary, for instance, has been copied from the ascension of Muhammad, a major event in Islamic sacred history. An example of an Islamic tradition applied here to Jesus is, for instance, the passage in the Catechism, and I quote, "While our Lord Jesus, his spirit, is stretching out his arms before him, in accordance with his words," he's speaking about the confession, Jesus is supposed to have said, "Whosoever approaches me one span, I will draw near to him one cubit. And whosoever draws near to me a cubit, I will draw near to him the length of two arms. And whosoever comes to me walking, I will come to him running." These words attributed here to Jesus are a widespread so-called sacred tradition, Hadith Qudsi. It's a special category of traditions in which not the prophet of Islam, Muhammad, but God himself speaks directly, mentioned in many different Islamic sources. This is a very well-known Hadith Qudsi. Used in this way, it could easily be understood as suggesting or evoking that Jesus is in fact God, because now the divine words are ascribed to Jesus. In addition, numerous specifically Islamic concepts are used in the Lead books to indicate specific Christian institutions, rituals, and customs. This is a phenomenon already en vogue in Christian missionary texts directed towards the Moriscos. In his Catechism of 1554, Bartolomé Dorador For instance, used Islamic concepts like faqih for priest, salat for mass, and mihrab for altar. I could add many other examples. The lead books considerably increase an identical use of such Islamic concepts. They use, for instance, al-jami' al-muqaddas, which is in classical Arabic, it is al-jami' al-muqaddas, the Holy Friday Mosque, but here to mean the Holy Church. Apart from all the Andalusi specificities in the morphology of its vocabulary, the lead books also presents several idiosyncrasies, we should call them, to be found especially in certain proper names and institutions. But this does not change the general character of the vocabulary or of the language as the as a variety of the Andalusi dialect. I have a section here in which we provide details about the composition of our publication, as it consists of a long historical introduction, the edition itself, which is ready at this moment, the introduction is also in an advanced stage of completion, and the translation, of which at this moment about 60% has been completed. And now I give the floor to my colleague, Professor Wiegers.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I continue now with paragraph 5, the narrative. So sigo con el paragrafo 5. Y sigo el texto en inglés, pero por seguir lo que estoy diciendo en la versión castellana. Entonces, 5. The lead books present themselves as direct sources for a hitherto unknown history of early Christianity, in which a turning point appears to be the revelation to Mary of a holy book, Kitab, called the Essence of the Gospel, Hakikat al-Injil, already mentioned. Mary was chosen as unique among women to make it known to the world. During her spiritual journey to the heavens, Mary saw her beloved son Jesus seated to the right of the heavenly throne, close to a dome in which she saw a book. She asked that she be granted to reveal this book to mankind. The wish was granted, and the essence of the gospel descended on her. The lead books inform us that the scripture was revealed after Jesus' demise and sent down on her immediately after Pentecost. In Jerusalem, Mary wrote this book, referred to as the original, Al-Asl, by her own hand with brilliant light on tablets made of precious stone. A copy, written on tablets of lead, was sealed by her with the seal of Solomon, already discussed. This copy on lead is the booklet number 17, which was in Spanish at the time called El Libro Mudo, because nobody could decipher it. Codicologically speaking, lead book number 17 has the form of all other lead books, which means it has a title page and opens and closes with the seal of Solomon, but it presents, as we have seen, with the exception of one folio, an unreadable script. The original essence of the gospel disappeared in the interior of Mount Olives, which burst open, so the lead books tell us, and then closed again. As we will see, as we will show, our research shows that this essence of the gospel is in fact identical to the Quranic revelation, and hence the lead books prophesize the conversion of the entire world to Islam. The historical narrative of the lead books then goes on to describe two journeys made by James, the Apostle James, to Iberia, and hence the lead books confirm that James evangelized in Iberia. James set out to Iberia with the essence of the gospel and with 6 disciples and goes, amongst other places, to the city of Ilabula, Granada. They then return to Jerusalem. And after the death of Mary, which is mentioned in the lead books, and her ascension to heavens, a council takes place. In the lead books, this event marks the moment when the decision comes about the guidance of Peter and James with regard to the teachings of the religious community, called the Holy Church. Based on the consensus of the community and the highest authority of Peter, the successor to Jesus, who is called Al-Khalifa, as we have seen, the vicar, James is authorized to write the Liber Fundamenti Ecclesiae, or Kitab Qawaid ad-Din, of which both the Arabic and Latin titles are preserved, a summary of the theology of the lead books, and a second book called Liber de Essentia Dei, or Kitab Fiedat al-Karima. Again, both the Arabic and Latin titles are preserved. I'm going to show you a few images. Here we have an engraving of Francisco Heilan of the tower in which the parchment was found in 1588. And you see that this tower was initially found very close to the cathedral that was built at that time and was demolished. So a contemporary engraving. Here we have a second engraving, which I wanted to briefly show you, an engraving by Heilan of the Monte Valparaiso, where he shows here the caves were discovered and the lead books were discovered as well. I'm sorry. So this is the historical narrative. Cecilio and others go with St. James to Spain. In addition to Jesus and Mary, they play a main role. And the center role in the lead books is played by the Holy Virgin Mary, to whom a holy book is revealed. They take this copy of the essence of the gospel to Spain and bury it then at San Cremonte. But I wanted to show you briefly this. This is the cover of Liber Fundamenti Ecclesiae, and as you can see, it shows a Latin text which draw the attention at the time of the authorities. Liber Fundamenti Ecclesiae are the first words you can read. And this is the same book that shows on the inside an Arabic text. So the books, some of the books, in fact, there are only the first two, show a Latin cover in which the title of the book is mentioned. As I said, these two books were written, and then James returns to Jerusalem. And next, after their return, they return again to Iberia, where he wishes to die. All the lead books, including the essence of the gospel, were hidden in the holy mountain, and James encourages his disciples to visit it after his death. And we have already seen that a pilgrimage is indeed what happens until this very day. The martyrdom and burial of James at the seaside, reference to Santiago de Compostela, follows. Finally, the disciples are martyred in Granada, and their martyrdom is recorded in the parchment. So the books suggest that the parchment was written at the very last stage of the life of the apostles and disciples in Granada. Our research, however, shows that the empirical history of the parchment and the lead books is in fact completely the reverse. The parchment is the oldest document. The lead books were written later. The parchment includes some elements that do not return later, which proves this, such as a reading of the canonical Gospel of John. Only there we find such a reading. The use of Spanish, whereas in the lead books we find consistently Yasuo as used among the Christian Arabs. Internally, there are also changes to be observed. For example, the concept of the essence of the gospel, so this very central concept, is only found in the books that were discovered later on. The first book in which it is actually mentioned is the book that was found in the 11th place, lead book number 11. The concept of the Trinity, however, and the Trinity, Incarnation, are mentioned especially in the parchment and the first lead books, and they disappear from the later books. The same holds true for the use of Latin. This seems to suggest that at the earliest stages of his activities, the authors tried to attract the attention of the old Christian population, in particular the clergy. This suggests that the books show a tendency towards an increasingly clearer Islamic message. The historical narrative of the Lead Books presents itself as Christian, but on closer inspection, this character appears to be superficial and only geared toward its outer appearance. The much more important subtext is an Islamic narrative, as we have already seen. This narrative is heavily imbued with mystical notions. In it, and this is the explanation of such phrases as Kullu Kitab Haq, in it, the key notion is that of the Hakikat al-Injil, the essence of the gospel, a concept that we have not been able to trace in Islamic sources. We would, however, propose that this concept in the Lead Books is to be understood as a counterpart or a precursor of the Islamic mystical concept of al-Hakika al-Muhammadiyya, the Muhammadan reality. This concept finds its origins in the widespread Islamic mystical philosophy of the unity of existence, Wahdat al-Wujud, of which the idea of the unity and oneness of religions formed part as well. This unity and oneness was thought to find its ultimate manifestation in Islam. The expression "every book is the truth," which is used repeatedly in the Lead Books, points into this same direction, as does the idea that the Injil is the spirit of the Torah, while the essence of the gospel is the spirit of the Injil. I will return to this idea later on. The major essentialist trend in Islamic mystical philosophy is constantly searching this distinction between illusion and reality, essence. The logical implication is also that the Quran is the ultimate manifestation of the single and unique reality as contained in the previous revelations, and this idea is clearly suggested by the various data provided concerning the essence of the gospel. One of the Lead Books, Lead Book 15, for example, reads, "From its light and its truth was created everything." This is most precisely one of the major attributes of the mystical concept of the Al-Hakika al-Muhammadiyya, as developed by Ibn al-Arabi and other mystical philosophers. Al-Hakika al-Muhammadiyya comprises the essence of Muhammad, which is manifested in the Quran. With this use of the concept of the essence of the gospel, the author refers to this reality as crystallized in the Quran. I will return to this aspect later on. Now, I'm going to speak a little briefly. We have a more lengthy argument about this and a more lengthy discussion, but I have, for reasons of time, I abbreviate this a little bit. But the summary of what we are saying about these elements is that there are elements in the Lead Books which discuss the Trinity, the Incarnation, and the Crucifixion. Yet, at the same time, these elements seem, according to us, Islamic. And the first of that of these elements is the central creed, "There is no God but God, and Jesus is the Spirit of God," which, as you can see on plate 10, is in a modified form to be found in Islamic texts and used by the Prophet Muhammad as an expression of the doctrine of, expression of the doctrine of faith, where he says that he confesses that Isa ibn Maryam is Ruh Allah. And the expression Ruh Allah, Ruh min Allah, is also found in the Quran. So this can be seen as an expression of a Christian creed in Islamic monotheist terms. Now, Trinitarian ideas are also found in the Lead Books, and also with regard to the crucifixion. And with regard to the crucifixion, there is a passage that is especially instructive because it shows the ambiguities that these concepts are used with in the Lead Books. And I'm going to read page 37, which is a quotation from a Lead Book entitled The Life of Jesus and His Mother Mary. And that suggests at least an ambiguity and suggests an openness towards the Quranic reading of the life of Jesus, where he was not crucified, but taken away by God. And here we read on that page that Jesus was taken away by God in the garden of Gethsemane, and that God completed his time through the angel, an expression reminiscent of the Quran, Surah 3, 45 to 55, where the Quran says Tawafahu. In this passage, the suggestion is made that it was not Jesus who was crucified, but another person instead, in agreement with majority Muslim doctrine. Now, in the lead books, and especially the oldest ones, Mary is referred to as being a virgin before, during, and after giving birth, in complete accordance with Islam, and as pure with regard to the sin of Adam, the first sin, Adhanab al-Awwal, as it's called in the oldest books. This last statement was interpreted by the Roman Catholic defenders of the books as a confirmation of the correctness of the dogma of the Immaculate Conception, which was at the time a very controversial doctrine. In later books, another expression is used, namely that Mary was pure from all sins and never had been touched by anything related to it. We may perhaps see this as an evocation of the Islamic doctrine of the protection of sin, Isma. And Mary, if we look at it closely, indeed functions as a prophetess, to whom a scripture, the essence of the gospel, is revealed. In the lead books, Mary ascends into heaven and is the recipient of revelations, events comparable to the ones narrated in the framework of such dirams as the Munajat, which we have already discussed. At the end of her nightly journey, as I've mentioned before, she sees the essence as a book, as a kitab, in a heavenly dome. And Pentecost itself was announced by the appearance of a heavenly light, and of the sending down of the Holy Spirit. And here, very clearly, the Quranic concept of revelation is used. So the nuzul of the Holy Spirit of the book is a Quranic expression. In one of the lead books tell us that Mary shows those present in Jerusalem during Pentecost both the original essence of the gospel as well as its copy. The original essence of the gospel disappeared during the night when a great light appeared, and Mount Olives, as I've mentioned before, opened itself and the essence disappeared into it. The history of the original tablets is therefore a parallel to the history of Moses' tablets, which, after being rejected by the people of Israel for the first time, were kept in the ark in the temple in Jerusalem. And it is very significant that Jerusalem in the lead books is referred to as Ramat al-Hamal, the hate of neglect. And this notion has a strong anti-Jewish polemical connotation in Islam. In our context, it symbolizes the divine rejection of the Jews and God's election of the Muslims. The copy, the nuscha, of the essence of the gospel is thus, in a way, parallel to the tables of Moses, taking to the extremities of the world, where it will be kept safe and serves, together with the original in Jerusalem, as a perfect guidance for those living there at the end of time. The apostles ask Mary about the contents of the essence, but Mary replies that the full understanding of it is reserved for those who live in the last days. As we have seen, one of the things God predestined for the end of time is the essence of the gospel, which itself is revealed to the Blessed One, Al-Ma'noom, mentioned in the Torah on the strength of his overwhelming bounty. It is a dhikr al-hakim, the wise admonition, and this last expression is a clear reference to Surah 358, where this expression, reminder of wisdom, reminder full of wisdom, is found. With the same expression, Muslim tradition also refers to the Quran itself. Adding to this is also the fact that the essence of the gospel is described as uncreated, evoking to the Muslim reader the dogma of the uncreatedness of the Quran. In conclusion, the essence of the gospel is conceived as identical to the Quran, but revealed to Mary, who in the lead books acquires the traits of a prophetess and above all as a saint. As many mystics, she makes a spiritual heavenly journey, and as a perfect example she has to impersonate the essence of the gospel on earth until her death. In Muslim readers, this will evoke the idea of the Insan Kamil, the perfect human being. And while mystics in general venerated Mary, as Annemarie Schimmel has pointed out, according to historical records, Granadan Mudéjars and Moriscos venerated Mary in a special way, even in comparison to the old Christian community. In conclusion, the place of Mary in the lead books is virtually that of a sinless prophetess and a saint. And even though her prophetic characteristics do not present a conflict with the finality of prophethood of Muhammad, for she lived before and not after him, this element is remarkable and certainly exceeds the boundaries of Islam. Now, we have already seen two images of the essence of the gospel, and I'm now going to show you briefly how the essence of the gospel is pictured in the chain of revelations in the lead books. And I'm showing you here all the concepts that are used for the earlier revelations in the lead books themselves. And they very closely connect to how these revelations are indicated in the Islamic tradition. The first is the scrolls of Ibrahim, Suhuf Ibrahim, the scrolls of Abraham. Then what is mentioned is the Torah of Moses, the Taurat of Moses, of Musa, the Psalms of David, and then the of Yasur. And then finally, at the culmination of this chain of events, of this chain of revelation, is the essence of the gospel. And as we argue, it is in essence identical to the Quran, revealed to Mary in the lead books. Now, I've briefly discussed the figure of the Man'um, the blessed one. And in the lead books, in many cases, the blessed one, a messiah-like figure, is mentioned in regard to Jesus. But there are ambiguities here. Many of the epithets that are used for Jesus are in fact well-known Islamic epithets of the Prophet Muhammad. You can find all these expressions in the text that we have handed out. But there are ambiguities here, and there is one text that makes clear that there is another Man'um which is referred to in the lead books. So the ambiguities in the first place are that the Islamic epithets of the Prophet are referred to as Jesus, but in one case, and you'll find it on page 38, 44 of the Spanish text, it is said that after Jesus, the Spirit of God will come to the world, a light from God, a nur min Allah, who will be the seal of the messengers, Khatam al-Rasul, with God's support. And the expression, the seal of the messengers, is expression we know from the Islamic tradition as a reference to Muhammad as the last prophet. Now, how will this truth be, how will it unfold? In the lead books, we find in several places and several books prophecies about the end of time that predict that a council will be held, and this council will take place in Cyprus. And during that council, the esoteric meaning, the hidden meaning of the essence of the gospel will be explained by an Arab, and then all heresies will come to an end, and one truth will prevail. As I said, since our conclusion is that the essence of the gospel, the book to be explained and made clear at the end of times, is in fact the Quran. And the situation to which the lead books refer is in fact the situation in which the Muslims in Spain find themselves. And here, with regard to that situation in which this truth will be unfolded, we find a number of expressions that we know also from the Islamic tradition as being used in Spain with regard to the Moriscos as a minority and the end of time. The perfect revelation already existed and circulated in 16th century Spain, namely the Quran itself as they saw it. Miguel de Luna was also the author of a historical and literary forgery, the so-called Historia Verdadera del Rey Don Rodrigo, of which the alleged Arabic original he had defended for some time as an authentic source. And this source did not exist at all. He had invented this book and the sources of this book. Luna defended the authenticity of the parchment and lead books on many official occasions in the presence of the archbishop and notaries. But in 1603, he was mentioned in an Inquisition trial as having said to other Moriscos that their context were fully Islamic. Both viewpoints may not have been mutually exclusive, however, if we follow the interpretation of the lead books that we propose here. This is even clearer in the case of a man who was in all likelihood a son of Miguel de Luna, Alonso, born in about 1570, who defended the Islamic truth of the lead books in 1618, 1619, when tried before the Inquisition. He spoke about his father in this trial, of which we only have a summary, as the Dr. Luna. And he said that although that father had died earlier, and indeed he had died in 1614, Miguel de Luna, he was not dead, and he was in some sort of an other stage. We cannot understand very well what he meant here. But in any case, he denies that he had died. We think that this man was the son of Miguel de Luna, who lived in Rome around 1609, 1610, and mediated between his father and the Vatican, including one of the physicians of the Pope, about a possible transfer of his father, who was in a precarious position because under threat of expulsion at the time. This man also was a Morisco physician, although he claimed to be an old Christian, which implies that he saw himself as having that status.